Welcome. We are at the end of our module, Section 6, which is on life cycle of the information security policy. In this section, we aim to give you an overview of the information security policy making process and discuss issues that policymakers must consider in information security policy making. Policymakers need to take into account a number of considerations, among them the rationale for a policy, the available resources to execute the policy direction, budgetary and legal requirements, and expected policy outcomes. In this section, these considerations are discussed in the context of the different stages of information security policy making. It should be noted that different countries will have slightly different policy considerations and contexts. The policy making process described in this section is generic and is based on the assumption that there are no existing national information security policy. As with other policies, the life cycle of information security policy can be divided into four stages: the information gathering and gap analysis phase, the establishment of the policy phase, the implementation of the policy phase, and control and feedback. You can see that in figure 19. In addition, a national information security policy should include the information security strategy, legal relationships, information security organization, information security technology, and the interrelationships between them. The first phase. The first phase in formulating an information security policy is information gathering and gap analysis. In information gathering, it is useful to review examples of information security and related policies from other countries as well as related policies within the country itself. In gap analysis, it is important to understand the existing infrastructure related to information security, such as existing laws and systems, as well as areas or gaps that need to be filled. It is an important step as it determines the direction for priority of the information security policy to be established. In information gathering, cases from overseas should be considered. In locating relevant cases in other countries, policymakers should consider similarities in the level of national information security, direction of policy and establishment, network and security infrastructure. Considering these similarities, the following material should be collected: information on the establishment and operation of organizations engaged in information security. And we have covered these in sections 2 and 5 of this module. Information security policy, laws and regulations, which we have covered in section 2. Internationally used information security methodology and examples from different countries, which we have covered in section 3. Threat trends and countermeasures or controls according to attack types, which we have covered in section 1 and 5. And countermeasures for privacy protection, which we have covered in section 4. In gathering domestic materials, although most policymakers are not experts in information security, they perform activities that are related or relevant to information security. Specifically, they craft laws, regulations, and policies in areas related to information security. However, because laws, regulations, and policies tend to focus on specific areas, the correlation among them might not be immediately apparent to policymakers. Thus, there is a need to collect and analyze and evaluate all laws, regulations, and policies that are related or relevant to information security. As Sun Tzu, the Art of War, says, know your enemy, know yourself. This means you should know your limits as well as that of your enemy. In the case of information security policy making, this would mean knowing what needs to be protected through an information security policy, as well as vulnerabilities and threats to information security. Gap analysis can be divided into two phases. First, understanding the country's ability and capabilities, that is, the organization and human resource, as well as the information and communication infrastructure in the general area of information security. Second, identifying the external threats to information security. Policymakers need to be familiar with the information security organization and human resources, both public and private institutions in areas related to information security. They should know the organizations involved in information security related work and understand their scope of work, roles, and responsibilities. This is important in order not to duplicate existing structures for information security. It is also at this point the experts in information security should be identified and tapped. Such experts typically have a background in law, policy, technology, education, and related fields. Now, the first step of gap analysis. The information communication infrastructure refers to the IT structure that collects, processes, stores, searches, transmits, and receives electronic control management systems and information. In short, this is the information system and network. Understanding the current status of the information communications infrastructure is particularly important from an economic point of view, because large investments are needed to connect the whole country, making the most of existing information communication facilities is advantageous. Figure 20 shows a sample information communication infrastructure for information security. It does not include all items that may be required and is given here only for illustrative purposes. Note the relationship among the various components of the network. The second step in gap analysis is to identify the external threats to information security. As mentioned in section 1, threats to important information are not only increasing but also becoming more sophisticated. Policymakers need to understand these threats and be able to decide what countermeasures are necessary. In particular, policymakers must understand, first, the penetration rate of threats to information security. Second, the most common and current attack types. And lastly, threat types and expected degree of strength in future. After analyzing national organizations, human resources, and information communication infrastructure, as well as grasping the threat components in the area of information security, it is important to derive the vulnerable components. This is determining the extent to which the country can resist the external threat components. This determination can be made by examining the following. First, the current status of CERT and its ability to react. Second, current status of experts on information security. Third, construction level and intensity of the information security system. Fourth, legal protection against information asset infringement. And lastly, physical environment for protecting information assets. The objective of gap analysis is to be able to identify the practical countermeasures that need to be taken. It should be emphasized that it is the most basic step in information security policy making. The direction. In formulating a national information security policy, it involves setting the policy direction first. Second, constituting the information security organization and defining the roles and responsibilities. Third, articulating the information security policy framework. Fourth, instituting and or revising laws to make them consistent with the policy. And lastly, most importantly, allocating budget for the information security policy implementation. In most cases, the pursuit of information security policy should be spearheaded by the government rather than left to the private sector. In particular, the government needs to set the policy, play a lead role in putting the necessary infrastructure in place, and provide long-term support. The private sector joins the project in time, principally to take part in research and development and system construction. Planning for private sector participation includes awareness-raising activities alongside building and strengthening the information communication infrastructure. If the government aims to encourage the private sector to accept the information security strategy, then government should play a supportive rather than controlling role. This includes distributing information security guidelines. Once the direction for information security policy has been set, the implementing organization should be constituted. Figure 21 is an illustration of the structure of a generic national information security organization. National information security organizations differ slightly according to the characteristics and cultures of each country. However, a basic principle is to ensure that the roles and responsibilities are clearly delineated. In the constitution of the information security organization, the administrative organization should have roles designated. The roles that we have illustrated includes the division vice president, who have primary responsibility for information collected, maintained, and or identified as utilized or owned by their respective divisions. They may be designated as information security officer or other individuals to assist the information security officer in implementing the information security policy. These designated staff must ensure that information assets within their span of control have designated powers, that risk assessments are conducted, and that mitigation processes based on those risks are implemented. Next, supervisors. They include directors, managers, etc., who manage employees with access to information and information systems and specify, implement, and enforce the information security controls applicable to the respective areas. They are responsible to ensure that all employees understand their individual responsibilities with regard to information security and that employees have the access required to perform their jobs. Supervisors should periodically review all user access levels to ensure that they are appropriate and take appropriate action to correct discrepancies and deficiencies. Next, Chief Information Security Officer, in short, CISO. He is responsible for coordinating and overseeing the information security policy. He works closely with the various divisions. The CISO may recommend that supervisors or specific divisions designate other representatives to oversee and coordinate particular elements of the policy. The CISO also assists information owners with information security best practices in establishing and disseminating enforceable rules regarding access to and accessible use of information resources. This include, first, conducting coordinating information security risk assessment and analysis. Second, establishing reasonable security guidelines and measures to protect data and systems. Third, assisting with monitoring and management of system security vulnerabilities. Fourth, conducting coordinating information security audits. And lastly, assisting with investigations, resolution of problems, and or alleged violations of national information security policies. Next, the CERT team. The CERT provides information and asset stakeholders in implementing proactive measures to reduce the risk of computer incidents and in investigating, responding to, and minimizing damage from such incidents when they do occur. The CERT also determines and recommends follow-up actions. The two-layer CERT is composed of an operational team charged with initial identification, response, triage, and determination of escalation requirements, and a management team charged with spearheading the national response to major or significant incidents. The CISO and designated IT staff members from Information Technology Services and Systems Development and Maintenance are part of the operational CERT. The CERT management team is composed of the Chief Information Officer, the Chief of Police, Director of Police, Public Information, Director of Information Technology Services, Director of Systems Development and Maintenance, the CISO himself, Systems and Network Manager, the Legal Advisor, a Human Resource Advisor, and delegates with technical expertise specifically appointed by the Vice Presidents. Next, I shall move on to the technical organization. The Information Technology Services Department staff members include Systems and Network Administrators, Engineers, and Technical Services Providers such as the IT Help Desk, User Support Technicians, and Voice Communicable Administrators. They are responsible for the integration of technical information security tools, controls, and practices in the network environment. They receive reports of suspected information security failure or incidents from end users. Next, the System Development and Maintenance staff members include developers and database administrators. They develop, practice, integrate, and implement security best practices for national applications and train web application developers in the use of application security principles. Next, I shall touch on other organizations involved. Employees with access to information and information systems must comply with applicable national policies and procedures, as well as any additional practices or procedures established by their unit heads or directors. This includes protecting their account passwords and reporting suspected misuse of information or information security incidents to the appropriate party, usually their supervisor. Temporary staff members are considered employees and have the same responsibilities as regular, full, or part-time employees with access to information and information systems. Consultants, service providers, and other contracted third parties are granted access to information on a need-to-know basis. A network account required by a third party must be requested by a sponsor within the organization. who shall ensure that the third party user understands the individual responsibilities related to network account and approved by the appropriate vice president or director. The user must keep his or her password or passwords secure and be accountable for any activity. Now, I shall touch on the establishment of information security policy. First, the information security framework. The information security framework sets the parameters for information security policy. It ensures that the policy takes into account IT resources, which is the people, information, documents, hardware, software, services, and it reflects international laws and regulations and meet the principles of information availability, confidentiality, integrity, accountability, and assurance. Figure 22 is an illustration of an information security framework. In the framework, you will find that there is first the area of plan and organization. This area includes security of organization and operation and asset classification and control. Security organization and operation covers the operation and system of the National Information Security Organization, the procedure of each information security organization, the constitution and management of the nation's information security, cooperation with the relevant internal international agency, and cooperation with an expert group. Next, the asset classification and control. It includes ownership grant and classification standard for important information assets, registration instruction and risk assessment of important information assets, management of access privileges over important information assets, publication and export of important information assets, important information assets revaluation and exhaustion, and lastly, security management of documents. The next aspect in the framework is the acquisition and implementation. This area includes human resource security and information systems acquisition and development security. Human resources security involves defining a management method for hiring new employees that includes, first, human resource security countermeasure and security training. Second, processing of breach of security regulation and the law. Third, security management by third-party access. Fourth, security management of access of outsourcing personnel. Fifth, work and management of third parties and outsourcing employees. Next, security management of computer room and equipment. Next, access to main facilities and buildings. And lastly, processing of security incidents. Information systems acquisition and development security requires security checks when an information system is acquired, security management for in-house and outsourcing of application programs, a national encryption system, which is essentially encrypt program and key, tests after program development, suggested security requirements when outsourcing development, and lastly, security verification with development and acquisition. The next aspect in the framework of information security policy, which may be considered, is privacy protection. The inclusion of privacy protection in an information security policy is not mandatory. However, including it is an advantage because privacy protection is an international issue. As covered in Section 3, privacy protection provisions should cover the following: personal information collection and use, prior consent when taking advantage of people's privacy, and PIA, which is privacy assessment. Next is the area of operation and support. This area has to do with physical and technical security. Use of the network and system is regulated in detail, and the physical security of the information and communication infrastructure is defined. This area includes the following aspects: information systems operation and security management, account privilege security management, and physical security. First, the information system operation and security management. This involves defining the following. First, the operation and security management of the server, network, application, and database. Second, development of the information security system. Third, the logs and backup against legal action. Fourth, information storage management. Fifth, the use of mobile computing. Sixth, standards for custody and security of computer data. And lastly, electronic commerce services. Next is the aspect of account privilege security management. Access control and account management have to be defined to guarantee confidentiality in the use of the nation's information depository. This includes, first, registration, deletion, privilege management of users of the national information system. Second, account and privilege management of encrypted information. Lastly, for physical security. Physical security refers to protecting information and communication facilities that keep important information. This includes, first, configuring and managing security area methods. Second, access and transport control for the computer center. And lastly, prevention of damage from natural and other disasters. The next area is on monitoring and assessment. This area of information security policy requires the formulation of standards and processes for preventing security incidents and managing and responding to security incidents. It involves security inspection as well as management and the response to security incidents. In security inspection, it includes establishing a security inspection plan, implementing periodic security inspection, formulating, organizing report forms, and lastly, identifying the subject of security inspections and report targets. For management of and response to security incident, it requires the definition of the work and role of each organization in processing security incidents. Procedures for observing and recognizing symptoms of security incidents. Security incident responding procedure and response method. And lastly, measures to be taken after security incident processing. Now, in the establishment of the information security policy, one of the aspects that must be considered is that laws must be consistent with the information security policy. There should be laws governing state organizations and private enterprise. Table 14 to 16 lists out laws related to information security in Japan, the EU, and the US respectively. In Japan, the representative IT law is the basic act on the formation of an advanced information and telecommunications network society. The law is the fundamental standard for information security in the country, and all related laws need to conform to it. Now, the implementation of a policy requires a budget. Table 17 shows the budget for information security in Japan and the US in the recent years. Something that you may wish to think about. If your country has an information security policy, trace its development in terms of the five aspects of information security policy formulation described earlier. That is, describe the policy direction, the information security organization, the policy framework, the law supporting information security policy, and the budgetary allocation for information security. If your country does not have an information security policy, outline some possibilities for each of the five aspects above towards the formulation of the policy. Use of the following questions as a guide. What should be the direction of the information security policy in your country? What organizational setup should be in place? What organizations should be involved in information security policy development and implementation in your country? What specific issues should the policy framework address? What laws should be enacted and/or repealed in support of the information policy? And lastly, what budgetary considerations should be taken into account? Where should the budget be drawn from? Next, in the policy execution step, Table 18 presents how the government, private sector, and the international organizations can contribute to national information security policy development. Effective use, collection, custody of information requires the proper administration and protection of the IT infrastructure. A good information security policy is useless in the absence of a sound IT infrastructure. The effective management and protection of information and communication infrastructure requires cooperation among the network, system, and IT area managers. It also benefits from cooperation between the public and private institutions. Refer to Table 19, for example. Responding effectively to threats and information security violation requires cooperation among national information organizations, investigative agencies and legal institutions, as well as organizations that conduct security accident inspection and damage estimation. It is also essential to cooperate with organizations that analyze technical vulnerabilities and prescribe the technical countermeasures. And in the prevention of threat accidents, preventing information security violations and accidents include monitoring, education, and change management. The National CERT is the main monitoring organization. A critical area is matching information policy and real monitoring data. Thus, it is necessary to discuss the scope of the information security information policy monitoring. Moreover, it is important to educate government and private sector employees as well as the general public about information security policy. It may be necessary to change certain attitudes towards information and behaviors that impact on information security. Information security education and change management are defined in the US SP 816, which is the Information Technology Security Training Requirements. Cooperation in privacy security is needed to establish internet privacy protection measures. Private location information incident prevention, protection of private biological information, and reporting of violations of privacy. International coordination. Information security cannot be achieved through the efforts of one country alone because information security violations tend to be international in scope. Thus, international coordination in information security protection, both in government and in the private sector, must be institutionalized. For the private sector, the relevant international organization for the promotion and protection of information security is CERT-CC. Among governments, ENISA for the EU and ITU aim to foster cooperation in information security among countries. In each country, there must be a government institution whose role is to facilitate cooperation by both government and the private organizations with international agencies and institutions. Finally, in the review and evaluation of information security policy, the final step in information security policy making is evaluating the policy and supplementing underdeveloped areas. Policy revision is essential after the efficiency of an information security policy has been determined. A domestic policy evaluation method can be implemented to determine the efficiency of the national information security policy. Aspects of this method will be discussed. First, use of audit organizations. There are organizations whose role is to conduct appraisal and evaluation of policy. Such an organization should conduct regular audits of the national information security policy. Moreover, this organization should be independent of the information security policy making organization and the implementing organization. Second, in revising the information security policy, problem areas are usually identified during the policy audit. There should be a process for revising the policy to address these problem areas. And lastly, the changes in the environment. It is important to react sensitively to changes in the policy environment, changes arising from international threats, second, and vulnerabilities changes in the IT infrastructure, great changes of critical information, and other such important changes should be immediately reflected to the national infocom security policy. Now, in summary, I have covered the information gathering and gap analysis, the establishment of information security policy, the policy execution steps, and the review and evaluation of information security policy. Now, I would like you to identify the government agencies and private organizations in your country that will need to collaborate and cooperate in the implementation of a national information security policy. Identify as well the international organizations that they need to coordinate with. For each area of cooperation in information policy implementation shown in Figure 23, specify specific actions or activities that these agencies and organizations can undertake. And with that, I'd like to thank you very much.